Gill's first book was about the radical suffragists in Lancashire. Later she wrote about women campaigners in Yorkshire, and there's also Rebel Girls as well.
Thanks very much, Barry, for those kind remarks. And thanks to Christian for organising today, and Mike for the bookstall at the back. What I want to do, if I may, is to tell the story of the Votes for Women campaign across Leeds through three of the city's most celebrated suffrage campaigners: Isabella Ford, Mary Gawthorpe, Leonora Cohen. And I want them to take us through the last few peacetime years, about the outbreak of war, and on to, of course, June 1917 in the Leeds Convention, where national suffrage campaigners, including Ethel Snowden, Charlotte Despard, and Dora Montefiore, all spoke. And then we'll go on to the parliamentary debates about women's suffrage and the passing of the Representation of the People's Bill, February 1918, Votes for Women at long last. So what I'm going to be doing is mapping a gender narrative, the exclusion from the franchise on the basis of gender, onto that of socialism and internationalism and revolutionary fervour that we heard about this morning. But let's start by recalling the Leeds suffrage campaign before war broke out, and who's read women? Who's read Rebel Girls? Anyone read Rebel Girls? Yes, thank you very much, because I'm going to be referring to that. And let's start with the founding of the Leeds Women's Suffrage Society in the 1890s, with its roots in progressive liberalism. No family exemplified this better or more vividly than the prosperous Fords, the Quaker family of Adel, who we've heard about this morning. Especially Isabella, here she is, a portrait in recognition of her work with women workers. And then in the 1890s, she was active in both the Leeds Women's Suffrage Society and the new ILP, the new Independent Labour Party. But in the Ford family, it wasn't just Isabella, it was also her talented sister, artist, painter, Emily. We've never been asked, it says, what a cheek. Her sister Emily was a member of the Artist Suffrage League, and both Isabella and her sister remain members of the giant National Union of Women's Suffrage Societies, the NUWSS, led by Mrs. Fawcett, and who adopted and retained constitutional tactics to fight for the vote. They were suffragists. They were suffragists, unlike those women in the WSPU, the Women's Social and Political Union, founded by Emmeline Pankhurst in her Manchester home in 1903. And this takes us, of course, straight away to Mary Gawthorpe. Here she's aged 18 in 1899 in a mother-made blouse. The Fords and upper middle class women would never go out in anything that was homemade like that. You used dressmakers, tailoresses. Mary Gawthorpe, so a different social class from the Fords, working class childhood in Woodhouse. Anyone here from Woodhouse? Nearby maybe. And on her 13th birthday, she leaves school and becomes a pupil teacher. Very meagre wages, very long hours. And here she incidentally meets Ethel Snowden, who's also training to be a teacher. October 1905, Mary Gawthorpe in Leeds hears the news from across the Pennines of Criswell Pankhurst and Annie Kenny at the Great Free Trade Hall in Manchester interrupting a Liberal Party rally, giant Liberal Party rally. When will the Liberal government give votes for women? They're hustled out by the Liberal stewards, they're arrested, appear in the magistrates' court the next day, refuse to pay the fine, and become imprisoned for the best part of a week. And thus the word suffragette is introduced by the popular press. Mary Gawthorpe, here in Leeds, immediately wrote to Christabel, and what she said is, "If it is necessary to go to prison in order to win the vote, I am ready." Christabel Pankhurst spotted a convert and followed this letter up with a barrage of press cuttings. Mary Gawthorpe was quickly hooked. She soon became a suffragette. And within months, Mary's down in Westminster herself at the WSPU demonstration. She's arrested for asking for votes for women and is imprisoned for 2 months in Holloway. 2 months for asking for the vote for women. And by this stage, she's already become a WSPU paid organiser and is whizzing about. Sometimes comes back to Leeds. Here she is, back in Leeds, February 1908. And I think we can just see her nephew, Sydney, here. Can you see what he's holding? It's a kind of tambourine, very useful for collecting pennies for fundraising, for sort of tambourine on a stick, her five-year-old nephew, Sydney. And there's Mary with her self-denial sash. So here we have two major suffrage movements. The National Union of Women's Suffrage Societies, led by Mrs. Fawcett, suffragists, and the WSPU suffragettes, led by Emmeline and Christabel Pankhurst. Key point, same aim, different tactics. And then there's a third organisation from autumn 1907, the Women's Freedom League, splits away from the Pankhurst WSPU over what they perceive as the lack of internal democracy. And led by Charlotte Despard, they set up the Women's Freedom League. And we'll hear a little bit more about Charlotte Despard later on. So that's the suffrage organisation, but let's look at the broader political context. April 1908, Asquith becomes Liberal Prime Minister. He is personally antagonistic to the notion of women's suffrage. Not that it's just politically inconvenient, which it was, but that it wouldn't do. He preferred women to be very attractive and to appear at weekends at country weekend parties, country house parties, and anything in between was inconvenient. So personal opposition from Asquith. One response to this from the suffrage movement generally was creative propaganda, banners. And I think at least one person here is from Colne Valley. Thanks, Cyril. And here's Florence Lockwood's Huddersfield banner, Votes Women. Sorry, it's a bit of a dark image. And there were banners like this being designed and embroidered right around the country. And then how to take propaganda out to the more distant parts. Why not have a horse-drawn caravan? It was a daring suggestion. It was particularly daring, you might argue, for upper middle class women for whom having domestic servants living in at home was something you just assumed would happen. But the first van set off a month after Asquith became Prime Minister in May 1908. The Women's Freedom League went vanning, Charlotte Despard too, and it toured the southeast. And the National Union, the suffragists, soon followed suit. And here's one of my favourite images, a picture of, I mean, I think most of us have been to Whitby, one way or another. And here's the caravan, and here's the suffragist speaker, and here's the harbour, and here's an Edwardian family, husband, wife, daughter, and baby. And you can almost sort of feel, sense what they're feeling, you know, on a holiday, they're listening to the suffragist speaker, and you can almost hear what she's saying as she tries to gather her audience. It was a real success. You know that hill going out of Whitby? That hill up to Goatland, just feel for the cart horse. So they did it again next year, summer 1909, and here's the next year, and here you can see Isabella Ford, even though she was amongst the older of the suffragists, and she's rather flustered, but she's joined in too. And I think we just need to bear in mind how daring and adventurous it was for an upper middle class woman like Isabella Ford to go out vanning around the Yorkshire countryside. But then, from mid-1909 onwards, votes for women's suffrage took a darker turn. It wasn't just Asquith's continuing hostility to enfranchise women. The Liberal government always had other priorities, and I think Punch, as always, gets it right. Here's Asquith shelving another women's suffrage bill. And have you ever seen a shelf more cobwebby? Here is Lloyd George looking a bit foxy. John Burns, president of the local government board, we'll come back to in a moment, and possibly, probably Churchill, looking a bit puddingy, and they're just thinking, they're just thinking, well, okay, we've solved our consciences, now let's get back to work. Maybe Lloyd George's National Insurance Bill, all important things, but do they have to be alternatives to women's suffrage? So procrastination by the Liberal cabinet and personal hostility from the Prime Minister Asquith. And then, from summer 1909, hunger striking by suffragette prisoners. And from autumn 1909, forcible feeding. And you know all too well what it was like. You sit back in your prison chair, your wrists and ankles held by four burly prison wardresses, while the prison doctor pours a sloppy food into a funnel and down a tube that's thrust between the suffragette's lips into her mouth. Immediately, accusations of barbarity were hurled at the Asquith government. Two radical journalists, Nevinson and Brailsford, protested in a letter to the Times, "We cannot denounce torture in Tsarist Russia and support it in England. We cannot do things that are so bad that we condemn them in Tsarist Russia." So being a suffragette was becoming to take its toll, an increasingly heavy toll. Mary Gawthorpe, she'd by now, since this picture was taken, been badly knocked about. Autumn 1910, after lengthy sick leave, she retired from being a WSPU organiser due to ill health. And indeed, after a year, Mary resigned from the WSPU itself. And by the end of 1911, she'd cut herself adrift from the Pankhurst WSPU. The broader picture of 1911, with a new conciliation bill to enfranchise a very narrow group of women, was wending its way slowly through Parliament. And for 1911, I want to focus, if I may, on three key events. The first is the census coming up, 2nd of April 1911. The WSPU paper, Votes for Women, says, "No vote, no census." And here is John Burns in his official regalia as president of the local government board saying, denying women the vote. But honest John Burns in his workman's suit, down on the knee, "But please fill in your census form." So they were pillorying the Liberal hypocrisy. The WSPU and Women's Freedom League, the two suffragette organisations, urge, incite all women, all disenfranchised, to boycott the census. Other suffrage organisations disagree. Fawcett's giant national union, the NUWS, says, "No, we won't break the law. The government needs this information, this data, for radical health and welfare reforms." So people like Isabella Ford and Ethel Snowden comply, as does the Women's Cooperative Guild, the big organisation of married working class women. So what happens on census night, 1911? The key, most celebrated boycotter was, of course, Emily Wilding Davison, hiding in her parliamentary cupboard over the weekend of the census. She becomes the best known. And then in their own homes, there's people like Charlotte Despard, leader of the Women's Freedom League in Battersea. But let's go north quickly. Mary Phillips is the WSPU organiser for Leeds and Bradford at this time, local organiser. And I'm not quite sure why, but she decided to go to Bradford for a boycott on census night rather than Leeds. And you can see she's pretty angry. No vote, no census. And in Vanishing for the Vote, I give a transcript of her very angry statement. There's her signature, and she refuses. There's 10 women hiding in the WSPU offices up Manningham Lane. I'm just an individual boycotter, resistor. I don't know much about her, Mrs. Thomas from Burley Grove, but all I do know here is information refused. She's refused to sign it. She is undoubtedly a suffragette. And I think this commercial postcard captures the optimism of the spring 1911, and also that went on into the summer of 1911. There were no arrests of the thousands of census boycotters. And in this moment of optimistic summer, we go to the next event, which is the coronation procession of June 1911. Optimism went right through into autumn 1911. Maybe this was the moment when women might begin to think about being enfranchised. But November 1911, Asquith received a deputation from the adult suffragists. Those, that is, the people, the organisations, it was called the People's Suffrage Federation in this case, who wanted the vote for all adult men, and at that stage only two-thirds of adult men had the vote, all adult men and all adult women. And it was supported by people like socialists, like Dora Montefiore. So a small deputation goes to Asquith asking for full adult suffrage, and they meet him in Whitehall. To them, Asquith casually announces a manhood suffrage bill, i.e. a bill sponsored by the Liberal government that would give the vote to all men and not a single woman. There wasn't a reference to women, but if anybody wanted to, they could add a little clause afterwards and see if they could have any luck with that. Absolute fury at this, absolute anger. And let's have a look at how the different suffrage organisations responded to this manhood suffrage bombshell. The National Union, who had its roots in liberalism, progressive liberalism, felt extremely betrayed, bitterly betrayed. And what they did, inspired by the ILP, the Independent Labour Party, is the Labour Party came round to supporting women's suffrage. They felt Asquith had taken a step too far of betraying women's trust. And the National Union and the Labour Party formed a Labour suffrage alliance. So Isabella Ford, here up in Leeds, campaigns for the Labour suffrage alliance and its funding, which is the Election Fighting Fund. So she goes to by-elections to fight for the Labour candidate in Keighley and Accrington. And I think, as Barry suggested in his introduction, you don't often get these sort of subtleties, particularly of Labour Party support in these crucial pre-war years for women's suffrage. The WSP, the Pankhursts, were equally angry and took it out physical militancy with window smashing raids. And even Mary Gawthorpe, who, as we know, had retired on grounds of ill health, was drawn back in. And in February 1912, she breaks the Home Office windows in protest. Time now to introduce our third Leeds campaigner, Leonora Cohen. She'd, like Mary Gawthorpe, left school quite early, and she'd become a millinery apprentice. She's now married to Henry Cohen, a businessman who's actually prospered, really, in his jewellery business, watchmaking, and is keen, is a staunch member of the Liberal Party and the Liberal Club in Leeds, and they have one son called Reg. Leonora Cohen is out in Leeds for the WSPU, selling newspapers, suffrage newspapers on the steps of the town hall, etc., etc. And then Asquith drops his adult suffrage bombshell in November 1911. And almost instantly, Leonora Cohen ups her involvement. Within days, the WSPU organises a deputation, this is still November 1911, down to London. And Leonora Cohen goes. She throws a stone, which she later claims was only thrown as a last resort, because she claims she's in danger of being trampled underfoot. She throws a stone at the local government board windows in Whitehall and gets 7 days in prison. Here is her message. This is my protest against the Liberal government for its treachery and torture of the suffragettes of Great Britain who claim the right to have the vote and become recognised citizens. And this is supposed to be what the paper she wrapped the stone round. I meant to put provenance doubtful because I think it's actually a copy rather than the original. And then when she came out of prison, she had her portrait taken at the Rosemont Studio in Bond Street in Leeds. So treachery and torture accusations at the Liberal government. By 1913, Leonora Cohen had become one of the most militant of suffragettes particularly in Leeds. So, for example, in February 1913, she goes down to the Tower of London. She mills around with beefeaters and the party of schoolboys and then whips out of her clothes some steel bars and hurls them at the glass case, which is smashed. She comes to trial by jury and the jury acquits her on a bit of a technicality. She is fearless. And here we have May 1913, so a couple of months later, the WSPU in Leeds on Woodhouse Moor. Might note the very elegant millinery. They're presenting themselves. We may be angry, we may be militant, we may be going to prison, but we present ourselves, we dress, and our hats are very elegant. A few months later, November 1913, Asquith visits Leeds. Was it a good idea? Was this the right city to come to? Leonora Quirin is there again and again smashes a window. She's again on trial. She's again in prison, in Armley this time. And she goes on hunger and thirst strike. This is getting very dangerous. December, Leonora is released under the Cat and Mouse Act, which, as you know, was a legislation passed earlier that year, which allowed suffragettes, prisoners who are going on hunger strike, to be released and to recover their health and to get some food so they can feel a little bit better, and then to be, if they could be rearrested. Henry, her very loving husband, using the Leeds Liberal Club headed notepaper, and I think most of you will know where the Leeds Liberal Club was, down towards the station, writes a scorching letter to the Home Secretary. He says to the Liberal Home Secretary, "My wife is in a state of utter collapse. If her life has to be taken, it will be on your conscience, not on mine." He is incandescent with anger that this Liberal government, a government of a party he supports, should be doing this to his wife. We can just sense how angry and concerned Henry is about his wife's health and about what's happening in Leeds, his home city of Leeds. So they decide to move, and I think they discussed it quite amicably, that's my feeling. They decided to move to a nearby town that was more sedate. Any suggestions? Harrogate. Definitely a safer place. And there, Leonora opens up a reform food boarding house, sort of vegetarian health food. And just along the side, we don't want to forget that the National Union, Fawcett's National Union, and the Labour Suffrage Pact, Isabella Ford campaigning with the Election Fighting Fund. And thus it was that the war broke out in August 1914. It broke out pretty unexpectedly for most campaigners, unless they had a reading knowledge of German and were pretty up to date with the situation in the Balkans. Before about June 1914, most people hadn't quite got that. It was a sunny summer. From August 1914, suffrage campaigning was suspended broadly, with individual campaigners within the main suffrage organisations making different choices and taking opposite trajectories. And let's just have a look. Emmeline Pankhurst, likewise her eldest daughter Christabel, and also Mrs Fawcett from the National Union, they all become pro-war patriots. They toe the government line. And it's difficult to say exactly, but I think the majority of women suffrage campaigners went along with that. Obviously, we can't put figures on that. Differently are the internationalists. Sylvia Pank has been mentioned, had been WSPU until there was expulsion, and she's now moved to the East London Federation of Suffragettes. The National Union, Isabella Ford, Ethel Snowden, Women's Freedom League, Charlotte Despard, and women like that join with their European and North American sisters and try to get to the conference at The Hague in spring 1914, where is formed the International League, which a bit later became the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom. And our two other Leeds campaigners, well, Mary Gawthorpe, here's her passport photograph, It actually says December 1915. She sails in January 1916, emigrates to America, to New York State, where she marries and remains for the rest of her life. And Leonora Cohen began working in munitions, like so many other women. So for the rest of the talk, let's jump to that hectic and crucial 12 months, 1917-1918. The context is, of course, as we know, conscription, war weariness, the DORA, Defence of the Realm Act, house searches. And had women, all still disenfranchised, got anywhere nearer to winning the vote? There was a few early stirrings in spring 1917 of a women's peace crusade, particularly in big cities like Glasgow, and a women's peace rally on Woodhouse Moor, May Day 1917. But it was really spring 1917 with the exciting news coming across from Russia, with the forming of workers and soldiers councils, and then bringing us together today, 3rd of June 1917, the Leeds Convention. 294 delegates from the ILP. This was right up the ILP's street. 54 delegates from women's organisations, the Women's International League, the Women's Labour League, and that big organisation of married working class women, the Women's Cooperative Guild. So which suffrage campaigners spoke? Well, Charlotte Despard did, Dora Montefiore, adult suffragists, says, hail the Russian Revolution, Margaret Bomfield, Emmeline Pethick Lawrence, plus two we'll just focus on. The first is Ethel Snowden. The Russian Revolution owes as much to women as to men. The Russian revolutionaries are honouring women by placing them upon the councils. They're doing common justice to the women by giving them the vote. Loud applause. And Sylvia Pankhurst from her organisation, now called the Workers' Suffrage Federation. We have never had real liberty in this country. The revolution in Russia is not only political but also industrial. I hope you're going to see to it that some of those, the women you choose for the Workers' and Soldiers' Council, are those sweated workers and the mothers who live in the hovels and slums. And again, she speaks to loud cheers. But I think it's worth remembering from this morning, it was alluded to, that summer and autumn 1917 was bewildering, frenetic, everything was happening so fast. Followed by the Russian Revolution in October. But let's just pause and look at our main purpose today, which is to map women's suffrage progress, if any, onto these exciting geopolitical revolutionary events. So what was happening, if anything, to women's suffrage now? Well, as early as 1916, rumours had begun to circulate that the government was preparing a new registration bill. It had to. Of course it had to. Conscription was just being introduced, and you had to enfranchise those soldiers coming back from the front who could vote in the next election, who might not satisfy the property qualification of the existing franchise laws. Of course you've got to have a new registration bill. So how did women's suffrage campaigners respond? There were various demands. Emmeline Pankhurst now relegated women's demands well below those of the British soldiers. She had really done a 180-degree swift on that. At the other end of the spectrum, Sylvia Pankhurst, her middle daughter, and the Workers' Suffrage Federation uncompromisingly called for votes for all adult men and all adult women. It's not terribly likely to happen. Maybe. And in between, the National Union, Mrs. Fawcett's NUWSS, has a more moderate demand. Women's suffrage, yes, but not necessarily for all women over the age of 21. Maybe some sort of compromise could be found. Given the new franchise bill that was inevitable to come in because of the need, the imperative to enfranchise soldiers, there was pressure on government to include women. Indeed, two cabinet ministers even hint to Asquith that they would resign if women were left out. As Swiss government is now about to hand over to Lloyd George, less antagonistic personally to women's suffrage, but more pragmatic, I would say, and an all-party conference under the chairmanship of the leader of the House, the Speaker of the House of Commons, is set up. This conference of mainly backbenchers and some peers would debate in private, in peace and quiet, away from the noise of war, these tortuous issues, and come back to the House of Commons with practical proposals. And this is what we need to look at, the timing of it. And I think this, for me, is the crucial slide. This is the crucial chronology. So from October 1916, the Speaker's Conference begins to sit, and it goes on to January 1917. Behind closed doors, they indulge in a bit of quiet horse trading. The Tories insist on some concessions for the business vote. Other people say, talk about electoral reform. A little bit of horse trading. But women have got to be included. But the problem with women is there so many of them. And how can politicians ensure that such volatile creatures don't form the majority of the electorate? The conference wants to make a gesture towards women, but not a complete capitulation to voting for all women. And this takes us to New Year 1917. And the Speaker's Conference recommends the enfranchisement of 6 million older women and the House of Commons to decide whether it's over the age of 30 or over the age of 35. And we need to remind ourselves that there may have been the first revolution in Russia, but Britain is having this discussion within quite a conformist ideological context. I'll give you one example. One eminent politician recommends, around the notion of motherhood and the family, an additional vote for every married men and women who had produced 4 or more children. Which didn't get anywhere, but that he would express it and think that he could get some support, I think is quite revealing. Meanwhile, the National Union is campaigning amongst women munition workers. Of course they are, because that's where most of the women working between the ages of 15 and 30 would be working. But they do find it thankless. It is in the middle of a war. And in the end, it's decided to omit women under 30, even though it is they, between the ages of 15 and 30, who worked in the munitions and took men's jobs. So May 1917, a bill including the long fought for and long awaited women's suffrage clause passed its second reading in the Commons, and then we have the Leeds Convention. And then in mid-June, just after that, the House of Commons debates the committee stage of the women's clause. There's a buzz of excitement, but it passes easily. No one wants to return to the situation that was in Leeds and other cities before the war. So now, the bill, having got through the House of Commons, has only got to go to the House of Lords. Only the House of Lords. Surely no problem there. Except, of course, the House of Lords, as anybody who's looked for 3 minutes at women's suffrage history would know, is a bastion of anti-suffragism. Most particularly Lord Curzon, who is the president of the League for Opposing Women's Suffrage, who is also the leader of the House of Lords. It's a bastion of die-hard anti-suffragism. But by now, late 1917, even the most die-hard anti-suffrage peers, seemed to realise their days were numbered. Lloyd George had clipped their lordship's wings before the war, reducing their powers, and now news from Russia, October 1917, reverberations from the Bolshevik Revolution right across Europe. How are the Lords going to respond to that? Well, interesting timing, because the House of Lords debate is just weeks after the Bolshevik Revolution. So how do the Lords respond? Well, one Earl soberly remarks, ruefully perhaps, "The vote is granted nowadays on no kind of fitness, but as a substitute for riot, revolution and the rifle." I think this is very, very revealing. We don't want to go back to the militancy and conflict before the war, and now it's got worse with news from Moscow of riot, revolution and the rifle. He's sort of bowing with the time. The leader of the House urges peers to abstain rather than oppose the Women's Clause, since rejection of the Women's Clause may involve us in a struggle from which the House of Commons is not likely to resist, i.e. our abolition or further clipping of our wings. And finally, obviously written a little bit later, so written retrospectively, Sylvia Pankhurst's suffragette movement. The shock to the foundations of existing social institutions, already reverberating from Russia across Europe, made many old opponents of women's suffrage, particularly in the House of Lords, desire to enlist the new enthusiasm of women to stabilise the parliamentary machine. And there, I think, you have it. The feeling in the House of Lords, the feeling of what they could get away with, what they ought to do in the aftermath of the Bolshevik Revolution. Because any combined uprising of unenfranchised women, disenchanted soldiers and industrial workers would surely threaten the very fabric of British constitution. So come the hour, their lordships, despite Lord Curzon, etc., chose the lesser of two evils, and it went through by 134 votes to 71, with 13 lords abstaining on January the 9th, 1918. So, 7th of February 1918, the Representation of the People Bill received the royal assent and became law. A struggle for votes for women that had started in the 1860s with John Stuart Mill, lasted to 1918, over half a century, at last reaps victory. It is victorious. And just to end up with the Leeds women who campaigned for this victory. The oldest and longest serving was, of course, Isabella Ford, born in 1855, so even before John Stuart Mill made his statement in Parliament. Died aged 70 in 1924. She'd already grown very tired, I can just sense that. So she died 4 years before women's final suffrage victory in 1928, when women over 21 won the right to vote, equal political rights with men. But Isabella's steadfast contribution was recognised with a blue plaque, thanks to Leeds Civic Trust. October 2009, a blue plaque to Isabella Ford put up on Addle Grange, their family home. So thank you. And I think half this society, the Ford Wire Society, named after her. She'd be quite secretly pleased. Second, Mary Gawthorpe, born in 1881, now in the United States, wrote her vivid and very honest autobiography, Uphill to Holloway, which was published in 1962. There's a copy in the bowels of the Brotherton, or you can occasionally get copies secondhand. She died in America in 1973, and her great nieces deposited her manuscripts in the New York Library, which I've been to consult, the Panamint Library, which is where these photographs come from. And I was very proud to be invited to unveil her Leeds Civic Trust blue plaque, April 2015, I don't know if anybody was there, in Bramley, Nine Worrells Mount, where she lived from 1905 to 1907. And finally, and definitely the oldest, Leonora Cohen, born 1873, and in the 1920s, despite her window smashing and despite her prison sentences, she was appointed a magistrate and awarded, dare I say this now, an OBE. and I think here we might want to balance the subtlety of the British state. She has smashed windows. She had been to prison. She had been on hunger and thirst strike. She was a very respectable upper middle class wife of businessman Henry Cohen, bastion of the local liberal club, and epitomised respectability. Leonora died in 1978, aged 105, not before BBC Television's drama series Shoulder to Shoulder, based on the Pankhurst story, depicted her on the front page of the Radio Times in 1974, and there she is. And also a blue plaque just opposite here, and perhaps if you've got 2 minutes, you can just go and have a look. Michael Meadowcroft, June 2007, unveiled her plaque, and afterwards we came here to Swarthmore and I spoke about Leonora Cohen. So just very, very finally, historians debate the reasons why women over 30 won the vote in February 1918. Some people say it was women's war work. That's what Asquith said in the House of Commons in the debate. That's the reason why he was changing his mind. And it's why certain historians, Arthur Marwick's probably the best known, go along with that. I don't find on its own, it's a very convincing explanations, not least because the women who actually did the work, who were mainly between 15 and 30, were excluded. But let's pause on that. Second reason, possibly the Russian revolutions and their reverberations, fear of riot, revolution and rifle. I don't think we want to exaggerate this, but I think it's there at the background. It's certainly with the House of Lords debate, it provides a context, a backdrop to sharpen the peers' minds that they should do the right thing. Thirdly, and particularly for cities like Leeds, fear of a return to what Henry Cohen had seen, the sort of anarchy, pre-war dangers of militancy and of women dying because of forcible feeding, hunger striking and the Cat and Mouse Act, and the fear that women would mobilise again if they weren't offered something. Fourthly, the rightness of women's political demands. It is surely a cornerstone, you might argue the cornerstone of democracy, that all adults over 21 or maybe over 18 should all have the vote. It's something without which you can't begin to call yourself a democracy. And finally and fifthly, possibly the fact that the war, not per se the war made women's votes over 30 more likely, but what the war did was break that logjam between the Tories, who would enfranchise women on a property basis, and the Liberals, who felt that would put them out of power, and let's clarify that in discussion. That broke down because you no longer had a single party in government, you had multi-party government and an all-party speakers' conference, so you could have this quiet horse trading behind the scenes, and I think that wartime kind of coalition of parties made it possible to break the pre-war party political logjam. You'll each make up your own minds of which of those five causes have the most weight, and while you're making up your mind, I'll just end on 2018, Vote 100, the centenary of women over 30 winning the vote. That's next year, and February onwards there'll be a whole succession of celebrations, and I know there'll be something in Leeds. And just one thing that I'm involved in myself, which is a digital mapping project based on 1911. So here we have the census schedules, and here is a woman in way out by the Welsh border, quite nice calligraphy, refusing to fill it in, plus a census badge, plus census mass evaders in a house in South Manchester, no vote, no census, plus the procession of June, and here are two badges, plus a mapping where we'll, and I'm not on the technical side, so I can't explain how, but we'll somehow be able to click onto your street, your village, your city, your town, and up will come the suffragist, the suffragette who lived down your street. So, including Leeds, and I hope I've done honour to Leeds' three suffrage campaigners. So thank you, Leeds, for doing your bit for winning women the vote.